I'm Youngmoo Kim, and this
is Applied Digital Signal Processing.
In this video, we explore several types of digital low-pass filters. No, not that kind of smooth operator.
Filtering, or manipulating a signal as a function of frequency, is a common operation for all kinds of signals, and certainly sound. For example, with music, we manipulate frequency to increase the bass or treble. We call this frequency equalization, or EQ. I'm on my way, I'm making it. As you just heard, to emphasize the bass, we reduce high frequencies, or increase the low frequencies. We call this a low-pass filter. To boost the treble, which is a kind of brightness, we limit the low frequencies, or create a high-pass filter. You can probably imagine uses also for a band-pass filter, which reduces both high and low frequencies on either side of a range. Low and high-pass filters are also used in a speaker crossover, which sends different signals to each of the subspeakers or drivers within an enclosure, which are each tuned for different frequency ranges. The larger one is called the woofer, which is optimized for lower frequencies, so it might receive and produce a signal like this. Higher frequencies require quicker response and faster movement. This is the job of the tweeter, usually a smaller, lighter speaker tuned for higher frequencies. I'm on my way, I'm making it. Some speakers will have even more drivers, another for a mid-range, or a subwoofer for very low frequencies. But put together, hopefully they provide the full range of audio frequencies for your music experience. I'm on my way, I'm making it. Right now, we'll focus on low-pass filters, those that eliminate or reduce high frequencies. Later in the series, we'll see that high-pass and band-pass filters are closely related to and actually can be derived from low-pass filters. One way to see and hear the effect of low-pass filtering is to start with a signal consisting of nearly equal contributions of all frequencies. This is white noise, so-called because white light consists of equal energy of all frequencies, meaning colors in terms of light. This is also something we'd call spectrally flat. See and hear what happens as we start to filter white noise through a low-pass filter and continue to reduce the cutoff frequency, or the boundary between the frequencies that are passed through and those that are filtered out. Remember, high frequencies have short periods with respect to time. They fluctuate quickly, enabling rapid changes in a signal. Conversely, low frequencies have longer periods, so they change more slowly. A low-pass filter allows the slower changes through unimpeded, but reduces or eliminates the faster changes, which has the effect of smoothing out the signal. So a good low-pass filter is, in fact, a smoothing operation. Let's take a specific example from what we've learned about sampling. As we saw in the last video, sampling creates aliases, or copies of the original signal centered at higher frequencies. These aliases become apparent if we want to change the sampling rate of an already sampled signal.
By the way, we encounter this same issue converting from discrete time samples to a continuous time signal, say for sound playback. You can think of that as increasing the sampling rate to the point where the distance between samples is infinitesimal, so that it's continuous.
Let's say we have a signal sampled at 11,025 Hz that we want to increase to 44.1 kHz without distorting the original signal. But in this case, we've just repeated each sample four times, which results in the right number of samples for a rate of 44.1 kHz. This results in a signal that looks like a series of stairs, with rather sharp transitions between the steps. If we look at it in the frequency domain, starting from a sampling rate of 11,025 gives us a Nyquist rate of half that, or 5512.5 Hz, which is the limit of information in the signal. But if we get to a sampling rate of 44.1 kHz by just repeating the samples, we've introduced a good amount of aliasing distortion. Basically, everything above around 5,500 Hz, which you can definitely hear in this audio. So what can we do about it? Well, we need to low-pass filter this to remove or at least reduce the aliasing. We're familiar with the spectrum and STFT, so you may be tempted to just multiply the spectrum with another function in the frequency domain. But there's a couple of reasons we're not going to do that right now. First, we haven't yet seen how to get back to a time signal from the frequency domain, which is what we'd need to actually play the filtered signal back as sound. It's possible, but as we'll see in a future video, it's a bit more complicated than it might seem. Also, we may want to implement filtering on a much shorter timescale than a Fourier transform window, maybe even sample by sample. Having to wait until we've collected enough samples to do a Fourier transform might result in an unacceptable delay. So let's return to the time or sample domain to do some straightforward processing, which we can then visualize in the frequency domain. Remember, low-pass filtering is smoothing, so we need to smooth out the steps of our signal, which is causing the aliasing distortion. The first method we'll try for smoothing our signal is to average nearby samples as we move forward in time. Let's apply such a moving average to our signal. Averaging a group of samples is the same as multiplying the signal by 1 within a limited duration, shown here as 9 samples in yellow, and 0 everywhere else, and then summing the remaining samples and then later dividing by the number of samples to compute an average. You can think of this as a window that slides or moves along the signal to focus on a limited region. This moving average results in the green samples at the bottom. We can describe that output, y of n, as a sum that depends on the position, n, shifting with respect to the input signal, x. I'm calling our moving average window h of n, which is currently shifted by 3 samples. In this summation, m is just an alternative variable for time, which we sum across the entire signal. But in this case, our window, h, is only non-zero for 9 samples. So it's just a sum over 9 samples. And as we change index n, the window location shifts. As we shift our window and sum across more and more of the signal, you can see it has the effect of smoothing out the steps of the input. This shifting sum operation is so common in signal processing that it has a term of its own, convolution. And we've given it a dedicated symbol, the asterisk, for convenience. So the moving average filter smooths out the signal. Looking at its spectrum over time, it looks better than our original, which is in the background. But there's still a little bit of weirdness. What's going on with these frequencies? The filtered version seems to extra attenuate those frequencies more than those in between. Let's see if we can figure out what that moving average window is doing independent of a signal. We've seen how we can put white noise through a filter to understand what it does, but it makes it hard to see some of the details. How about if we put in a single sinusoid and increase the frequency? Remember, this is called a chirp signal. We see how it attenuates the signal at higher frequencies overall, but kind of bounces through some frequencies that go to zero amplitude. Here's our moving average window, which we also call the filter's impulse response, since this would be the output if our input was an impulse function, or 1 at time 0 and then 0 everywhere else. We'll come back to that impulse response shortly. We can also look at the window function in the frequency domain by taking its Fourier transform. Now, as we change the length of the moving average window, we see that we alter the characteristics of the filter, the cutoff frequency and the position of those valleys, which we call zeros. This is an inherent feature of the moving average filter. We didn't particularly hear the impact of those frequency zeros in our sound, but what if we have a signal that is sensitive to those frequencies? Is there a different kind of low-pass filter without those zeros? Well, rather than a moving average, what about taking a running average across all the samples of the signal? Could we incorporate all the previous samples, but perhaps give extra weight to the most recent ones? Let's go back to the aliased repeated sample version of our signal. A running average would keep a running tab of all previous samples, but more heavily weight the more recent ones. As we see, our window now starts at time zero and extends to the current moment. We still multiply our signal with that window to obtain the output samples in green. In this case, I'm weighting the samples by powers of 0.9, which gets smaller as we go further back in time. We can express the equation a bit more compactly as a summation. And this starts to look familiar since we're multiplying and summing with a function that we shift with respect to time. If we define that function again as h of n, a variable often used to denote a filter, we see that it's another convolution. Note also that this window function or impulse response goes on forever. It never truly becomes zero, so we call this an infinite impulse response. You may have noticed that there's also a more efficient way to compute this. Rather than summing across all previous inputs, we can express the next output sample as a weighted sum of the previous output and the current input samples. This is why we sometimes call this a recursive filter, since it directly uses prior samples of the filter output. It also makes it clearer why its impulse response is infinite. It will approach, but never truly get to zero. Now, convolving over the signal, we can see that this running average filter also has a smoothing effect. If we put a chirp signal through, we can see how the running average filter attenuates the signal more smoothly at higher frequencies without the bounces through zero. In this filter, instead of the length of the impulse response, which is infinite, the weighting coefficient we use changes the low pass cutoff frequency. Note that the coefficient must be less than 1. Otherwise, with more and more samples, the output will increase to infinity, which we call an unstable filter. So we'll keep that coefficient less than 1. The two methods for low-pass filtering we've covered form the basis of all digital filters. The moving average results in an impulse response that at some point becomes 0. Hence, it is a finite impulse response, or FIR, filter, which has a characteristic frequency response with bumps, or side lobes. The running average filter has an impulse response that approaches but never completely becomes zero, so it's an infinite impulse response, or IIR filter, which can have a smoother magnitude frequency response. As you might imagine, we can create many variations on either type, changing the weights, durations, and combining FIR and IIR methods to craft all kinds of filters, which we'll cover in future episodes. But in either case, we smooth the signal by convolving it with the impulse response of the filter. Note the effect this has in the frequency domain. If we put white noise, which is spectrally flat, through either filter, the result is multiplication of the frequencies of the noise with the frequency response of the filter. Let me say that again, and I'll leave you with this to ponder. Filtering, or convolution in the time domain, is multiplication in the frequency domain. It's true, and we will prove that in the next video.
Thanks for watching, and see you next time.